Sir Philip Craven was born in Bolton and attended Bolton School Boys Division, where he was a keen swimmer, cricketer, and tennis player. In 1966, age 16, his life took a very different turn when he had a fall during a rock climbing expedition. That accident left him without the use of his legs. Despite this, he has gone on to achieve things that the rest of us could probably only dream about. Since 2001, he's been president of the International Paralympic Committee and has been a member of the International Olympic Committee since 2003. He was knighted in June of 2005. I'm delighted to say that Sir Philip Craven joins us on the line now, just days before the start of the 2016 Paralympic Games in Rio. Sir Philip, can I thank you for taking time to speak to us?
Well, you can, but it's a real pleasure to speak to you, Mike. I know you as a pretty good basketball and wheelchair basketball commentator, so it's great.
Listen, I've got to start with a probably a difficult question.
Oh, right, go on.
How are you at the moment?
How am I?
Yes.
Well, normally, you know, as an IOC member, I go to the Olympics. It gives me a great opportunity with our CEO to check the venues out for the Paralympics and really have a very enjoyable Games. In Rio, I had a very enjoyable Olympic Games, but it was full on for 18 hours a day. I averaged 3 hours sleep over 22 days, and we had two major issues, which I'm sure you're aware of. Our board decided to suspend the Russian Paralympic Committee over state-sponsored doping, and also we uncovered throughout the period of the Olympic Games the state of finances for the Paralympic Games, which we knew little about until we arrived in Rio. So, how am I? I was pretty tense throughout that period, but I've had 7 days back at home doing some work, but in a very different environment. I'm looking now at an apple tree that's laden with apples for the early in October and a pear tree and different things. So, I'm ready for action again.
Have the problems in Rio somewhat tarnished the 2016 Paralympic Games for you?
Not at all. Why should it? I mean, I think this relatively small but dynamic organisation called the International Paralympic Committee has just had to go into overdrive. It's not the first time, but this is probably the most intensive three-week period that myself, our CEO, Javier Gonzalez, and our vice president, Andrew Parsons, who you may think's British with a name like that, but he's Brazilian. And he's been crucial in our dealings with, negotiations with the federal government in Brazil, with the city authorities headed by the mayor of Rio, and also with several legal organizations, both federal, state, and city, with regard to the transfer of monies that we know are there.
You mentioned in your previous answer the Russia ban.
Yeah.
How did you come to the decision to ban all Russian athletes from the Paralympic Games?
Well, we didn't actually ban the athletes. The process was that following the publication of the McLaren report that Professor McLaren had been asked to write by WADA, the World Anti-Doping Agency, on the 18th of July of this year, we became aware for the first time that Parasport had been involved in what the McLaren report stated was state-sponsored doping in Russia. And we had 20 days, really, and up to the 7th of August, when we announced our decision. And we had to build up a picture, which was a pretty damning picture, so that our board meetings on the 3rd and 5th of August could come to the decision, which was to suspend the Russian Paralympic Committee, our Russian member, and the only organization in Russia that we could address this situation to. And we decided, because of what we had found from the McLaren report and further information from Professor McLaren between the 18th of July and the 3rd and 5th and 7th of August, that we had no alternative but to do that.
But even the Olympic authorities didn't go that far, did they?
Well, they did it slightly differently, and I think that they accepted to a great degree what was in the McLaren report, but I think the way I would describe it was that they decided that they should leave the investigation to each of the international federations that would be responsible for each of the Olympic sports that was part of the program at the Olympic Games in Rio. But we felt, and we're in a different situation, we have a different structure to the IOC. The IOC, I'm a member of the IOC, and it's made up of individuals, over 100 individuals, the membership, whereas the membership of the IPC is made up of over 200 members, most of which are National Paralympic Committees all over the world, who will be sending teams to Rio. And so we had that difference. We are an independent organization, as is the International Olympic Committee, with whom we have an excellent working partnership on many, many issues. And therefore, we both had our own independent decisions to take. And at no time before we took our decision did the IOC try and influence our decision that was taken by our board. There are 15 members of our board. 13 have the vote. The other two that don't is the CEO and the co-opted member of the board. And 12 of those 13 voting members were present for the meeting, and all 12 voted, and all 12 voted unanimously in favour of the decision. So this wasn't a decision of the president, myself. This was a decision of all 12 voting members that voted on the issue.
If I can ask you one more question on this point.
Sure.
What message would you give to the Paralympians in Russia who do not cheat, who do not take drugs?
I think it would be put best by what I said during the press conference on the 7th of August, where we announced our decision. And that was that, in the opinion of the board of the IPC, in taking this decision, they felt that this wasn't a situation which you normally find in the few positive doping tests that we have in para sport, that the athletes are abusing the system in place for making sure there's no doping in sport. And it was completely the opposite way around. This was a state-sponsored doping system that abused those Russian athletes, whether they were clean or whether they cheated and, if I may say, were dirty. And therefore, it's very, very different. It's not the IPC that's been handing out a sentence. It's really come from the state of Russia and their involvement in state-sponsored doping. And therefore, what I say to them is press your state authorities to abolish such practices and adopt proper practices so that we can be sure, as the IPC, and we can be sure and we can welcome back the Russian Paralympic Committee and its athletes into parasport competition and future Paralympic Games.
Beijing was a fantastic Games for the Paralympics, and that was followed, of course, by London, where many of the Paralympic athletes became household names performing in front of massive crowds.
Yeah.
Give us some of your recollections of London 2012.
Well, because I'm an IOC member, I was a member of the board of London 2012 for the 7 years that the board and the organizing committee were organizing the Games. And I think every board member felt that we were going to have very good Games. But I was still amazed. Amazed by the athletic performance, both at the Paralympics and at the Olympics. Amazed at the spectators that turned out for both events. And really, Britain, the UK, was alive with Olympic and Paralympic sport from when the Olympic torch landed in Cornwall in May of 2012 until the closing ceremony of the Paralympic Games in September. And so that's what I remember. But I also remember one other thing, which was amazing teamwork between the different authorities, entities that were involved in different parts of organising the Games, whether that's the organising committee, the IOC, the IPC, the security services, local authorities, central government, and don't forget there were two very different political parties in charge of the country. It was Labour when we got the Games in 2005, and it was the Coalition when the Games took place in 2012. And so that's what amazed me, the way different bodies can come together and not say they're number one, but just get together and produce amazing Games.
I have to tell you that on the first day of the wheelchair rugby at the basketball arena, it was truly, truly awesome. The most amazing sporting event.
It's pretty good, his wheelchair rugby, but it's not quite up to wheelchair basketball.
I used to think that I could not go on. And life was nothing but an awful song.
Well, as you've said, I had my accident. I've just checked out because I'm going to celebrate 50 years in a wheelchair this year on the 25th of September. The day after, I went to the Bolton Infirmary, I think, spent the night there, and then was transferred to Southport to the Spinal Injuries Unit there. And was in what today would be called the Intensive Care Unit. I think it was just for new admissions, really. But outside the window was the tennis court that had been converted to an outdoor basketball court. On the second day, I saw the team training, and the team from Southport. So it was in my blood immediately, I suppose. And when I got up in the chair, I played table tennis, snooker, different things. And then within a year, I was starting off on this, what for me, and this is not me looking at me as a player, but just an amazing journey here, playing sport and loving wheelchair basketball. I hated the training at swimming, by the way, even though I was a pretty good breaststroker. So I was glad to jack that in relatively quickly and just concentrate on the love that I had for wheelchair basketball, but also similar to the love that I have for cricket, you know, and I'm still a cricket nut. And I'm about to watch one of the one-day internationals now between Pakistan and England. So, yeah, that's it, really. And then I went to university at Manchester. I'd been offered a place at Cambridge, but I thought, no, I'm not going there. They don't have a decent wheelchair basketball team. So I went to Manchester. Manchester were the stand-up basketball champions of Britain. I don't think they had an English player in the team, but I trained with them for 3 years at Manchester, doing skills, not playing matches, because otherwise I'd crack all their ankles. So that's where I picked up the game. Then I went to play in France, and that's where I met my future wife. We've been married for 42 years now, and life's great.
How does the future look for the Paralympic movement?
Very rosy. You know, there have been real difficulties in making sure that the games in Rio are going to firstly take place and then be a very good success. But I think everyone's going to be amazed at what happens there in Rio. Those games are going to be quite spectacular when you think of where they've come from, the difficulties that we've had. And then if we look forward, next Winter Games are in Pyeongchang in Korea. The next Summer Games are in Tokyo, and they're absolutely avid fans already of the Paralympics. And then we're back in Beijing for the Winter Games of 2022, and we'll know about 2024 in September of 2017 when the vote takes place in Lima, Peru for who gets those games. So it's very rosy indeed, looking forward. My main objective, and I've only got a year to go as president, then I have to retire because I'll have done my requisite number of terms, is just to make sure that more and more people all over the world can experience playing para sport and just get the benefits from it, whether that's becoming a Paralympian or whether that's just using sport as a vehicle towards a better life.
What is there left for Sir Philip Craven to achieve?
Not a lot, really. People say, oh, what's your legacy? Well, I don't look at legacies. I just look at hopefully leaving an organisation that I became president of 15 years ago in 1 year's time in a better position than maybe it was then. If it isn't, then I've not done a great job. But, you know, in our CEO, Xavi Gonzalez, we've been a team, and teams start with two people, you know, always. And he's fantastic. He's one of the greatest international games organizers in the world at the moment. And so I've got a great team there. I've got a great vice president, Andrew Parsons, and a wonderful board. What more do you want? And then, you know, I'll be 67 when I finish, and there's still a good few years in me for something else, you know. So there we go.
You must be absolutely delighted with the way that Paralympic sport is being portrayed on television by Channel 4.
I am absolutely over the moon. I know they got the games in London 2 years before the games took place, and I do know from speaking to them afterwards, they were incredibly enthusiastic. They put forward a very good bid for the games to the organising committee. It wasn't the IPC that did that, it was LOCOG. But I know that two of them sat in a room after they'd been given it and they said, now what do we do? They've had to be inventive, and they have been inventive ever since. I mean, we know about the superhuman program, but this new video that they've done, Yes We Can, it's just mind-blowing. And where they found the singer from, you know, an Australian who I think was lost in the bush somewhere in his wheelchair, and now he can sing like Frank Sinatra or Sammy Davis Jr., you know, it's... They're an inventive, small organisation relative to other bigger organisations, one of whom I'm speaking to now, and we love them. We love Channel 4. We also love the manner in which BBC have been portraying Paralympics, you know, particularly on their news programmes, and it's just great. And it's just, hey, get behind this great sport. Why is it that it's being portrayed so well, not just by Channel 4, but by others also? It's because it's what I've really always wanted. We're about sport. We're not about disability. We're about great individuals. We're about, and I'd like to split the word here, we're about superhumans, not about superhumans, even though, you know, that's the way maybe they come over. But that we've just got some great, great people in the movement, and we want more.
Finally, and I hope this isn't a difficult question for you, what is your message to individuals who will become disabled today, next week, next year, and think that their life is over?
Well, first of all, they won't become disabled. So let's drop the D word. They'll still be the same individuals, you know, if they lose a leg or they lose their sight or their hearing, or they're born with some condition that gives them that. What we always have to remember is every individual is an individual. It doesn't matter whether you've lost a leg or whether you wear glasses or whatever you do, you know. Every individual is an individual personality. And that's how these people, that all people in society have to be viewed. And all that society has to provide to them is the possibility for them to develop their own lives, make their own decisions about their own lives, move forward and make decisions and move left, move right, go forward, go back, and your life will be dependent on the decisions that you take. The last thing you want is you lose a leg and everybody thinks, oh, no, you can't decide what you want to do yourself, and they start telling you what to do. Well, if anybody starts doing that with me, they're in big trouble, I can tell you.
Sir Philip Craven, can I thank you very much indeed for taking time to be with us. Congratulate you on all that you've achieved personally and that you've achieved for the Paralympic movement, which is sensational. I can remember one country in particular who used to say they didn't have any disabled people. Yeah. And they stepped up when the time was right for them.
Absolutely.
And it's been fabulous seeing it over the past 10, 12 years. And your job in that has been fantastic. Wish you all the very best for the future.
Very good. See you soon.
There is but one freedom. Man running alone. Each step that he's taking, a step to his soul. The passion and courage it takes to be there. The spirit